Welcome back friends, welcome to another video tutorial from Shomu's Biology. In this video lecture, we'll be talking about IR spectroscopy, which is also known as infrared spectroscopy. You know, infrared is belonging to our normal electromagnetic wavelength. If you look at the wavelength, it is a large wavelength. It's much bigger than the visible wavelength that we can see. So that's why we can't see infrared, but this infrared light can be very beneficial for understanding the structure of different chemical compounds, especially the structure of different groups or chemical groups of those molecules. So IR spectroscopy is also known as vibrational spectroscopy or the chemical group or group related spectroscopy. Now what does that mean? IR spectroscopy depends on, or it actually helps us to find out the structure of different chemical groups that are present in a molecule. Mostly the functional group and the presence of functional group can be very well detected with the help of IR spectroscopy. For understanding the structure of unknown chemical compounds, we have different techniques. We have NMR spectroscopy, we have X-ray crystallography, we have mass spectrometry. But this one, this IR spectroscopy is not that powerful to give you a data about the whole chemical compound, but it is good enough to give you an idea about the functional group that are associated with the target molecule that you are experimenting with. So let's go into it. In IR spectroscopy works in a very simple principle, and that principle is the bond between the different atoms. The atoms that are present in a chemical compound, they are bond or linked with each other, either with a single bond or double bond or even triple bond. So those molecules can have saturation or unsaturation throughout the whole process. It depends on how those bonds are behaving. Because if you look at the bonds, if you look at a chemical compound and atoms are linked with bonds, those bonds are not permanent, it's not fixed. They are always involving with different type of motions. That could be vibrations. They are known as those bond vibrations. The vibration means, let me give you a simple example. If you are talking about a carbon attached with a hydrogen, for example, or let's say carbon attached with a nitrogen or oxygen, for example, that interaction, it could be with a single bond or it could be the interaction with a double bond. But in any sense, you can imagine that these two atoms, they are linked with not a simple line, you can think of it as a spring. So that means, if you imagine this is attached, attached with a spring with an oxygen. So now you think this spring can go from each other towards each other, or it can come towards each other like that. So the spring can be like dragged opposite to each other, or sometimes can be towards each other. So by this fashion, what we can see is an oscillation, you can see this sort of oscillation that is known as wagging. That's not wagging, that's kind of a stretching, we can say. It is known as stretching. So this bond, they can have a stretching effect if you can take it away from each other and also bring them close to each other, just like a spring will do. Stretching is always going on in all those bonds. There is also another effect known as wagging. What is that? For understanding that, let's take one compound as an example, and that is, let's say, formaldehyde. Formaldehyde, if you take, this is the structure of formaldehyde, where carbon is attached to this oxygen. This is a carbonyl carbon, because it's a carbonyl group that we can see here. This carbonyl group, if we talk about, this particular carbonyl bond, forget about the hydrogens here, this particular carbonyl bond, if you look at here, just imagine the carbon is attached to the oxygen with a spring. So there is a stretching effect. So they have a stretching effect between this carbon and oxygen. They stretch like this over here. And also there is another effect, that let's consider this as oxygen is attached to the carbon, and just like this, it can also rotate in a zigzag fashion like that. This is known as wagging. This head is moving like this. So this is the wagging movement like that. So we have wagging and we have stretching here. Two type of effects that we can always see. So in this chemical compound, you will see always this stretching and wagging going on. Now there is a frequency by which the stretching continues and the wagging continues. Normally in case of this formaldehyde, the stretching is 2 hertz and the wagging is considered as 4 hertz. For example, say hertz is the frequency with which this stretching or wagging is taking place. For the stretching, the frequency is 2 hertz. For the wagging, the frequency is 4 hertz, for example. Now, what we see here for this compound, this type of rotation and vibrations around the bonds are very important for giving us the idea about the type of functional group we are looking at. Whether the functional group is carbonyl-carbon attached or it could be like any other type of bonds attached with it. There are different types of signature movement and signature vibration and stretching for different types of bonds. If it's a double bond, there's a kind of stretching. If it's a single bond, a different way of stretching. If it's a triple bond, that's another different kind of stretching. So those variations among those chemical compounds are going to give us so many different varieties of data which will help us to find out what kind of compounds we're talking about. Because I told you, our job for IR spectroscopy is to find out a target group, functional group, that's what we need to find out. Now, what exactly IR spectrometer does? Let's look at here. Let's take this compound as an example. And what we do here in the IR spectrometer, that we simply put infrared radiation. Let's say this is the gun, infrared. This is where the infrared comes in. We simply write it as a light source because it is light source. Just we can't see it because it's having a longer wavelength over there. And also the wavelength number is also a little big here. So this infrared radiation, this light source is coming in and this is the chemical molecule present here. So let me draw the chemical molecule like that. Now we can control the frequency of this infrared light that is hitting this compound. Let's say this IR is moving in a frequency of 1 hertz. Now we know that in this compound, the vibrations and the stretching and wagging, all these movements are, none of them are 1 hertz. The stretching is 2 hertz, wagging is 4 hertz. So as this IR is hitting this molecule in 1 hertz frequency, it is not going to influence this molecule. So this compound is not going to absorb any of that. So it's going to emit all of it. This is the idea. IR is hitting it 1 hertz. There is nothing going on in the 1 hertz frequency in this molecule, no bond expression in the 1 hertz. So all of this light that is passing through the molecule, it's completely passed. None of the light is absorbed. So at the end of this, at the end of this chamber, we have the detector. We always have detector at the end. Big D, it stands for detector. So detector detects 100% lights to be emitted. None of them are absorbed. So now, once detector detects that, detector is connected with the computer and that is also connected to the monitor screen where we can see a graph forming. Now, if I do the graph, how it will look like? It will look something like this. If I do the graph like this, in the x-axis, we are talking here about the percent emittance, the percent emittance, that is the percent emission, and the this is in the y-axis. In the x-axis, we have the wave number, which is in inverse centimeter. And we can guess it from, let's say, here is a 4000 at this point to, let's say, here is a 500 inverse centimeter. Okay? So this is the idea. And here we have the 100% emission at the top. And at the very beginning, there's a 0% emission. So this is the emission scale. So what we can see here, as all of this light is passed, none of them absorbed. So we see 100% emission here at the very beginning with 1 hertz. Okay, let's say for this understanding, we simply do this calculation in hertz, the frequency we're talking about. So at 1 hertz, we see 100% emission. Okay. Now let's change this frequency of IR light that's going in. Now let's say the frequency we go with 2 hertz. What will happen? we know that this C and O, this double bond, they stretch in the frequency of 2 hertz and they wag in the frequency of 4 hertz, right? So as the frequency of this IR hitting this molecule matches with the frequency of the stretching between the carbonyl carbon and oxygen, that is also 2 hertz, this compound will absorb most of the light, most of the IR spectrum, most of this light will be absorbed by this formaldehyde there, and very little will pass, very little. Theoretically it should absorb all the light because it will get the energy source and start stretching itself, but sometimes, you know, due to the practical experiences, you can see that some part of this UV radiation is also passed to the detector, but detector detects very less amount, which acts as a background noise, we can tell. So for the 2 hertz, if you look at here for the second 2 hertz, you will see a sharp drop. You see a drop in the emission. Now let's go back to the 3 hertz. If we now emit the 3 hertz, again, none of this compound, they have a 3 hertz frequency in anything. So again, they are not going to absorb 3 hertz, they are going to leave it away. So most of the light will be emitted. So again, in 3 hertz, you will find a steady, you have 100% emission. Now finally, it goes with the 4 hertz. Once it again fires it in the 4 hertz, the frequency of the IR radiation, that is 4 hertz, is again to inspire the wagging movement. So most of it will be absorbed, very few will be emitted, act as a background noise. In that case also, we'll see a drop. 4 hertz. So by this fashion, what we can see in this graph, this kind of graph you will see, it's very common type of graph for IR spectra. You will see a lot of things down, like normally it's 100% emittance, but then you will see the absorbance. This drop in the emittance means absorbance, that's what we are talking about. Absorbance. Wherever absorbance, that means this molecular compound that we are testing is absorbing the IR and that specific frequency that matches the frequency of stretching and wagging or the vibration of that functional group. Now this vibration of the functional groups are specific for specific functional groups. For this carbonyl, this will be fixed 2 hertz for this stretching, 4 hertz for wagging. Now remember, it also varies with the situation of this molecule and how other groups are placed. It's not that simple. Here we draw a very simple example. Multiple groups are present and it will have influence for the presence of other groups as well. And secondly, it also depends on the length between the bonds that are present between the two components here, which is in this case carbon and oxygen. As it's a double stranded bond, and also if it's a double bond, the stretching movement and the vibration will be different. The frequency of vibration will also be different. If it's a single bond, if it's a triple bond, it will be also changed. So based on the number of bonds, it will also vary. The length of the bond, it will also vary. So all these things matters a lot, and also the presence of other groups also determine what kind of absorbance it will actually have. So that in a sense of whole process. So now if you look at some of these graphs, you will see 100% emittance, and in the x-axis you'll probably find a lot of data, like in the wave number. The data in the wave number means it will be like centimeter inverse value of the wave number, and you'll see like 4000 here and 500 here. So this is going to give you an idea about the array. It's not about, we're not talking here about like let's say, let me just erase that, let me talk about erase this one. And let's say we are talking about the graph and the data about the wave number for the infrared. And wave number, we are talking here the 4000, and here we have let's say 500 only, and here we see the different emission in the y-axis. So what we see here, if you look at very carefully, you will see a lot of different peaks coming in, going down, like peaks like this. And at the end, after a specific point, you'll see something like that. What is that? I'm going to explain in a moment. There are two segments you can form by looking at any of this IR spectra data. One, it is completely based on the wave number that we are looking for this wavelength. The wave number that we are looking for, it starts from 4000 to 1800, that range, and then another range from 1800 to 500. Mostly from 4000 to 1800, that area of the data, it represents the functional group. Mostly it represents all the specific basics functional group that we know of in the organic chemistry. All those functional group, they range from this 4000 to 800. But now if you go from 1700 to 500, that range, that is mostly filled with very tiny modification among those functional groups, and that is very specific to the specific molecules. So that region of the spectra is very important, and the resolution is also very, very important at that end of the spectra, because that is known as the fingerprint region. This first area is known as the functional group region, because it will give you the idea about the functional group of the chemical compound, which will be very important idea. But the second one will give you the idea about the exact type of functional group you're talking about. It's going to give you the idea about the exact atom present near each other. That is known as the fingerprint region. Because this fingerprint region, why? Fingerprints are unique for all of us. So fingerprint region means this region will be unique to all those different chemical compounds. That is the idea. So for getting this, if you get a graph like that, and if you get an idea about the functional group and fingerprint, along with those two things, each other, it's going to give us the idea about what kind of chemical compounds we are talking about. And that's what IR actually do. IR spectroscopy will help us to get the idea about the molecules, different groups. And the presence of group will be very beneficial for us to calculate what kind of molecule we are talking about. That's all about infrared spectroscopy. I hope you understand this process. If you like this process, please hit the like button, subscribe to my channel to get more videos like that, and definitely share this video with your friends. Thank you.